Please stand as you are able. Good afternoon. Welcome, and on behalf of Brady's family, thank you for the gift of your presence this afternoon. Just a quick reminder, all the hymns that we'll be singing are in the hymnal. Those are in the pew racks in front of you, front pews, they are under your seats, and we ask you to follow along as you are able. I will say a little bit more later, but Brady wanted lots of hymns sung, so we're trying to accommodate his wishes as best we can. And so the final prelude hymn is, the final prelude song is a hymn on Eagle's Wings. We'll remain seated, but all of us are invited to sing. Let me ask you, if you did not get communion in the individual cups on your way in, but you would like to take communion, if you would raise your hand now and the ushers can take care of you. We've got a few over here. Anybody else? And one over here. So they'll get those distributed. David, do you take note of those folks? Raise your hand one more time so they can see you, and they'll bring that to you as we begin. We gather as God's people to celebrate Brady's life and to give thanks for the gift he always is and will be for all of us, for which we are deeply grateful. Let's sing together while we remain seated on Eagle's Wings. Welcome. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who died and was raised to new life by the grace of God, we gather to celebrate Brady, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to our merciful Creator, and to comfort one another in our grieving. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Everyone who is baptized into Christ lives their life in the promises of Christ. In his baptism, Brady discovered the claim upon him as a beloved child of God, living in God's embrace forever. Please stand as you are able. Let us pray. God of endless compassion and grace, we gratefully remember your beloved child, Brady. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. By your faithful presence, console us who mourn. Give us your help so we may see death not as an end to life, but rather as one chapter in your story of eternal life. May we continue our course on earth confidently, trusting in your grace, until that day when we are reunited with all who have gone before us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for Psalm 23, the hymn, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." So how long do you have this afternoon? Brady left plans for us, of course, for this celebration of life. And just like Brady, in a few bullet points on one sheet of paper of the requests he made me cry, he inspired me to give thanks to God, and he made me laugh out loud just reading through it. The quote on the front of your bulletin is part of his first paragraph of instructions. And when I read parts of this document to a few people during the last several weeks, everyone said one or both of two things. First of all, that's so Brady. And second of all, gosh, I miss him. And here are a few of the other notes from that document. Lois and I decided years ago on cremation, with ashes placed in the First Lutheran Church Memorial Garden. There are some special people there. We'll be in good company. Give more time and attention to the words of Scripture rather than any unnecessary recital of things I might have done. After all, most of them were helpful for a moment, but that moment is long past. There are too many Scripture passages noted here with too many verses. And I will say, Brady suggested we have 9 readings today. Brady continued, so those of you leading the service will have to decide what is appropriate for the occasion. That's your problem, he said. Then, don't keep people waiting too long for the reception. Brady wants his coffee. Yeah. Brady's last bullet point was about music. He suggested we sing 10 hymns, in addition to the 9 readings, of course, while also saying several times, keep it simple and don't take too long, don't go too long. But listen to the word from Brady on the singing. And I know many of us are in that place. Music can bring either joy or sorrow, or both. I hope that the tone will be joy, but I'm aware that each of us carries with us an inner container of sorrow that has been accumulating over the years, and anyone's death can put us back in touch with that sorrow. So let it be. Let it be. Thank you, Brady. Always the caring pastor. Beautiful words from his bountiful heart. So let's take some time and give thanks for Pastor Brady and be grateful that he answered the call to ministry in his life. One of Brady's chosen readings for today talks about that call, a reading from Isaiah chapter 40. A voice inside me said, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry out? All people are like grass. Their constancy is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God will stand forever. So go get up on a high mountain and be a herald of good news for God's people. Shout out with all your strength as a proclaimer of good news for God's children. Shout it out. Do not be afraid. Say to everyone within earshot, your God is here. Thankful to Brady for answering that call, to cry out, to proclaim the good news that our God is here. He helped all of us better understand that the Christian faith and life with Jesus is not only about going somewhere else when we die, but rather, more importantly, it's about helping Jesus bring about the kingdom of God here on earth in this life. Just like we pray every time we recite the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it already is in heaven. I can remember Brady and I having those conversations. Jesus said, the kingdom of God is at hand. Close is our hand, and I'm forever grateful that Brady helped me and all of us better understand that reality. So in recognition of Brady answering the call to ordained ministry, for which we are thankful, we have a word from our North Carolina Synod Bishop, Tim Smith, and to share that with us is Assistant to the Bishop, Pastor C.C. Mills. C.C.? Thank you for being here and welcome.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, I want to say that my brother Brady was a part of my life from the time I was a youth And Prince of Peace Greensboro used to do different things with First Lutheran. And then when he came as an interim to Prince of Peace, and we tried to stress him out as much as possible, he continued to be a blessing to me as I matured and have been serving as a pastor. His encouragement and his heartfelt expectation that we all would indeed tell everyone who God was. I read to you now a letter from Bishop Tim Smith. It begins, "Dear Lois, First Lutheran in Greensboro, and all family and friends of Brady Faggert, we, the rostered ministers, Senate Council and staff, and members of the North Carolina Synod, and indeed the larger ELCA expression of the church, grieve with you the loss of Pastor Brady Faggert. I also send greetings, sympathy, and deep gratitude for Pastor Faggert's life and ministry from ELCA Presiding Bishop Elizabeth Eaton. When I was a young pastor, Brady Faggert was for us the epitome of the pastor we imagined and inspired one day that we'd become. We all knew and looked to Brady as one of those rock-solid people of faith and as a selfless servant of the gospel. He served not just his congregations, but the synod, the larger church, and when Lutheridge was in a tailspin, he pulled them out of that as interim director. We join you in commending him to the Christ who claimed him in baptism and for whose proclamation Brady dedicated his life. We do regret that this pandemic has for so long postponed this larger celebration of his life and resurrection until now. I regret that I cannot be with you today due to a previously scheduled funeral for another retired pastor who died in 2020. And whose family has four times postponed that service. I'll be in Boone for the 1 p.m. funeral of Pastor Pete Wubens. I'm so grateful that one of our bishop's assistants, Pastor C.C. Mills, is able to be there with you to represent the North Carolina Synod and to share this letter. I am always humbled at the death of one of our pastors, especially considering Brady's ministry. As I consider all the prayers, hospital visits, confirmation classes, sermons, weddings, funerals, baptisms, and pastoral conversations, and leadership they have invested for the sake of the gospel. It's impossible to calculate the lives and decisions changed, comforted, guided by Pastor Faggert's witness to the gospel. I hope you all find comfort in gospel and resurrection hope today. And despite the real pain of grief, entrust Brady to the promise of the crucified and risen Lord. I hope you remember that the same Lord who holds Brady now in fullness also holds you in this life. And until we join him and all the saints who have gone before in the perfect reconciliation of all relationships in Jesus Christ." And he signs it, "Holding you in prayer, Timothy M. Smith, North Carolina Synod, ELCA." Thank you.
Hi, my name is Bernie Hess. I've had the joy of being connected with y'all since 85. But I knew Brady even sooner. Brady and I met at a training event for Word and Witness up at Lenore Ryan. I had just come to North Carolina to serve a church that its pastor had just died. And was I nervous? Yes. You know, those things about being a Yankee or a Southerner. Of you know now, I'm officially a North Carolinian. I've been here so long. But in any case, that event has marked my life in great ways. First, Brady Faggert, who taught me how to write a lesson plan, Would you believe in all my education, and I looked for the classes, nobody gave me a course in how to write a lesson plan. Brady did it for me. And it was especially meaningful for me because Brady was going through a difficult, difficult season. His associate, Phil Dees, had just recently died suddenly on a baseball diamond while standing at the plate. Brady had trouble with his back. Wonder how many things he carried emotionally that helped that back hurt so much. So Brady wasn't exactly in the greatest of shape, but when he saw that I needed help, he gave it. Well, that help continued as a friend, as a mentor, as an advisor, as even my spiritual director once I got to Greensboro. I served the church and this is interesting how life is what happens while we make plans, you know. Well, one place was I went to a church in this town to serve as their interim pastor, and I left there 13 years later. They were a troubled congregation. They were divided, and I needed help. And so Brady helped me. He not only helped me, but when we decided it was time to build, Brady came and inspired the folks and cranked them up and got them going. He was twice a major candidate for synodical bishop. By the way, Charlie, have you ever been a person's campaign chair again? Don't care to. Well, somebody else was called, and I came here in this room the Sunday afterwards because I wanted to support my brother, and he preached one of the best sermons I've ever heard in my life, the yes behind the no. And he continued his ministry here until he retired. Now, on the surface, Brady was soft and approachable, but underneath, he had a will of steel. Once he had decided on something, that's how it is. That's the way it's going to be. Now, I guess the Lord Jesus Christ would maybe change his mind, but I love the fact that he knew his heart, he knew what he believed, and he acted on it, both in this congregation and in this community. My life has been blessed by his presence, and I'm grateful to God for having known him, and as our funeral service says, for him to be a companion for me on my journey through this life. And I want to thank you as family for allowing me to say a few words today. But there's something else I better do, or when I see Brady in eternity, he will have a few words for me. His and my favorite chapter of Scripture is the 8th chapter of Romans. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I suggest you read it home and give yourself at least half a year to study it. But we'll give you selected verses and see how this affected his life. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But the very Spirit intercedes with groanings too deep for words. And the one who searches the heart knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work for good for those who love God and who are called according to God's purpose. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities or powers or things present or things to come, nor height nor depth or anything else in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
For those who don't know me, I'm Charlie Zimmerman. It was my privilege to be a teen pastor with Brady for 14 years and to be a part of his family's life throughout those years to this day. One of the things that I always admired about Brady was the depth and the breadth of his reading. He had a curious mind, an insatiable appetite for learning, and a curiosity that led him to continue to expand his mind and heart. One of the authors that we enjoyed was a man named Frederick Buechner, and in particular, his book, A Room Called Remember. This is the room to which you and I go to remember the people and experiences that have shaped our lives and blessed us. So it's to that room that I'd like to invite you today to remember Brady, his impact on your life personally as pastor, as friend, as teacher, as colleague, to remember his impact on our communal life at First Lutheran and beyond First Lutheran into the community and the worldwide church. I think the scripture passages that he's chosen, some of which we know, some of which we don't, certainly tell us a lot about who he was. And for me, he embodied those passages. Those are what grounded him. They were his compass. In Philippians 2, 1 to 5, Paul writes, "If then there is any comfort in Christ, any consolation from love, any partnership in the Spirit, any tender affection and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or empty conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interest, but to the interest of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus." So sit with those words for a minute. Life is not about us, but about God. God working in and through our lives to bring in God's kingdom of love. It's not about making a name for ourselves, but rather proclaiming God's name. Brady shunned the limelight. He preferred working behind the scenes. And I think that one of the reasons that our team ministry worked for 14 years was because we shared the same mind. That is, the same ministry philosophy, and we're willing to share center stage. We valued each other and realized both our differences as well as our gifts and how they complemented and supplemented each other. You should have been able to talk to Brady about being of one mind or being in full accord and in one mind. Because he'd be quick to tell you it doesn't necessarily mean thinking alike and agreeing. Brady enjoyed debating, wrestling together with ideas, trying to find where the wisdom in the midst of everybody resided. And it was coming out of the debate that Brady would hope that we would be in agreement and of one mind. He taught us how to hold in tension opposing points of view and differing perspectives. We were free to disagree, and we did, while at the same time respecting each other. That's what love does. That's what the mind and the heart of God does. It recognizes differences while it sees each person as created in the very image of God, gifted by God, blessed to be a blessing. This mindset led Brady to be among the first to engage in what was called the Lutheran Catholic Dialogue and our eventual covenant with St. Pius. To enter into conversations with the pulpit forum so that we could begin to bridge the racial divide, create friendship so that if something happened in the community, we could sit down and we could talk together. And into ecumenical relationships with the large congregations in the community. His ambition was to know Christ and to proclaim Christ crucified, risen from the dead. To press on toward the goal, toward the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. In a word, your dad was driven. He was a lifelong learner. He was a tireless doer. But above all, he was a servant leader. He never asked me or anyone else that I knew of to do as he did, but to sense what God was calling us to do and to be the person God created us to be. He wanted to engage each of us in this journey of faith, or as Paul would say, to work out our salvation. Not that we could earn our salvation, but to work alongside God, living into the gift that God gives to us. To cultivate and nourish our relationship with God, and to realize above all, it's God who works in and through our lives to bring in the kingdom. He was a masterful teacher and proclaimer of God's word, opening our eyes and hearts to see new possibilities and perhaps to catch a peek at where God might be at work in the world. He reminded us that God was always bringing new life out of loss, making whole that which was broken, healing our hurts and our heartaches. As was already said, he believed that resurrection wasn't just for the end of life. Not at all. It's for in the midst of life that God reaches into the chaos of our lives, those very places where you and I feel broken and beaten, lost and forlorn, and bring something new up out of those ashes. Brady was a visionary, and I like what Daniel Evans says about vision. Vision is not always about being right about the future. It's about constantly learning what's right and striving for it. It's a vision of uplifting people and ideas that benefit the marginalized. I will always be amazed at what Brady was able to see, because he saw what many of us are blind to seeing or quick to dismiss and put out of sight. Paul writes in Romans 8, verses 9 to 11, if the alive and present God who raised Jesus from the dead moves into your life, he'll do the same thing in you that he did in Jesus. Bingo, that's what happened with Brady. God moved into his life, and Jesus' presence through Brady reached across racial barriers, societal barriers, to embrace the outsider, the marginalized, the neglected, and forgotten. Out of all the areas where Brady was involved, there are three that will always shine for me. The first was resettling Montagnards in Greensboro. in partnership with Lutheran Refugee Resettlement. The second came really late in his career when we started a ministry with Hispanics called La Vela. And in both these instances, what Brady did was not sit in his office and call people and make plans. He went, got immersed in the lives of the people and the leaders, trying to learn what is it that they need, how do we provide the social services, making sure they had what is needed, operating out of a theology of abundance, and cultivating friendships with those he met. After he retired, now we're talking 70s and 80s now, Brady got involved with homelessness and hunger, partnering with Todd Herman, Andrew Chamberlain, and George Arnold, who went and were trained so that we could have a Friday morning First Lutheran breakfast group at Greensboro Urban Ministry. And as that ministry evolved, it was Lois and Brady arriving at 5:30 a.m. to open up, get all the supplies out, set the tables, start making the lunches, scrambling the eggs, and serving the people. But what he loved the most was partnering with the other servant in the team and interacting with the homeless men and women. You see, for Brady, the breakfast was a sign of God's banquet table to which all are invited, all are welcome, all are fed. And that's what it means to empty ourselves and become servants so that God's love can bring healing and hope to other people. What was Brady's lasting impact? I can hear him say, "You tell me." And for me, he was a servant leader in whom and through whom the light of God's love shone brightly, who loved the Lord his God with all his heart, soul, strength, and mind, and his neighbor more than himself. In whom and through him, I experienced God's graciousness, acceptance, and love. He was a man for others who saw a need and responded, who saw injustice and took action. He never shied away from a challenge. So hear the ending of Paul's words, as Bernie did. I'd say go back and read Philippians when you have time. But hear Paul's words as Brady's words to us. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. And as for the things you have learned and received and heard and noticed in me, do them, and the God of peace will be with you.
Thank you, Charlie. Thank you. Thank you, Bernie. Thank you, Charlie. Thank you, Cece. I asked Lois and Laura, what are some things you want people to know about Brady? All of us knew him to some degree, but all of us who have spoken so far knew him as the pastor, the professional, the colleague, the one up front leading the way, and the one masterminding the ministries in the community and beyond. So I said, what was it like to know Dad? And Laura and Lois shared some things. Lois said, among other things, and of course, as a loving husband and father, what do you remember most? And Lois did a little free association. She said, free spirit, spontaneous, detailed, energetic, fun-loving, penny pincher, coffee drinker, animal lover, social butterfly, traveler, champion of social justice, and Christian by thought, word, and deed. And then she listed a few memorable times, and I can't share them all, but a few of them worth mentioning. Walking to St. Mark's in China Grove with Laura and Dad, just a few blocks from the parsonage at 4 or 5 years of age, reaching up high to hold his hand, watching him preach with his white robe on, thinking he might be an angel up there. And at my grandfather's viewing and Dad's reaction to seeing his father, telling me, "That's not him, he's not here, he's with God." Jumping into the lake at Luther Ridge, fully clothed when we were hot. Dad didn't want to take the time to go back for bathing suits, and then getting in trouble with Mom as a result. Playing basketball in the driveway in New Jersey, one-on-one, getting my teeth chipped from our intense play. Then playing football in the side yard in New Jersey with Laura and Dad. Us getting run over when being taught how to block. And we realized we preferred playing basketball instead of football. Listening to him cry on the phone when I told him he had a grandson, and 3 years later, a granddaughter. And, last thing Lois shared, being bear hugged by Brady at the airport whenever was the best feeling in the world. As I read that from you, Lois, and thought about it, it hearkened to mind John's gospel, where Jesus said, "If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." And good and loving parents don't do that, don't they? One of Brady's readings comes out of the John tradition and goes so well with these memories. John 1, chapter 4, "In Jesus the Son, we have come to know and believe the love of God and that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them." Thank God for Brady's big heart, full of God's love, not only as pastor and colleague and friend, but also as husband and as dad. Among the things that Laura mentioned were these. He loved the natural world. He loved getting out in creation. He'd connect with God there, and he wanted people to understand how important it is to take care of the earth, to take care of this amazing home that God has given us. And as already mentioned and well known, he was the ultimate people person. He could get in conversations with anyone, anywhere, and launch into at least a 15-minute conversation, if not longer. And in that amount of time, he would know who they were, everything about them, draw out something from them that made them feel special. There's a story floating around of a gas station where the kids were in the car and Brady pulled in to get gas. And I think they were on vacation, something like that. Anyway, he got out and started a conversation with the person at the next pump. And the conversation went on and on and on. And everybody's like, "Let's get on vacation, Dad. Let's get going wherever you were going." And he gets back in the car, gets ready to pull up, starts telling everybody about everything that happened. And Lois said, Lois Senior, Mom said, "Did you get any gas, Brady?" "Oh, oh, gas." Turn back around, get back out and pump some gas. Yeah. But he could tell them everything about that person he had just met at the gas pump. And he had a need to help people. Even to a fault, even to the point of getting taken advantage of. But that was just him. He saw a need, and by golly, he was going to help. And then, as has been mentioned, his penchant and passion for justice. He always rooted for the underdog. His passion for justice just could not be contained. He would get so upset when the big dogs would take advantage of the underdogs, and it drove him, as has been mentioned, it drove him all the time. And one of Brady's readings for us fits these thoughts from Laura so well. Matthew 11, Jesus prayed, "I thank you and I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent, and you have revealed them to infants, for such is your gracious will. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus' yoke, that is his body of teaching, was the incredible love of God. It was undeniable and always undeserved and no strings attached. And that gives us rest. Todd's here, as Pastor Charlie mentioned, Todd Herman, former president of the congregation and member of church. He and I are fans of the original Star Wars movies. We grew up during that time in the original Star Wars movies, and Todd and I always know that we refer to Pastor Brady as the Jedi Master. And we can tell you, we know that the Y stands for young, but it also stands for Yoda in our eyes. He is the Jedi Master of our faith and our mentor, for whom we are always grateful. And we'll always remember that about him. Todd started the First Lutheran Church Friday Breakfast at Greensboro Ministry, just celebrated 16 years of serving breakfast to the homeless every Friday morning. Many of you are here and a part of that. But Todd admits it would not have happened without Brady's input, Brady's support, encouragement, and spiritual guidance as that was coming into being. And very quickly, 2006, he helped lead our first mission trip and accompaniment trip to Costa Rica from First Lutheran Church down to join the Lutherans in Costa Rica. And when he got back, as a result of that, he started the conversations about there are so many Latinx members of our community that need our help, need God's grace and love in their lives. And so the La Vela movement, which took several expressions over several years, was born out of that, thanks to Brady. And then he had further conversation about that with Pastor Christina Johnson down at the Gum Friday Breakfast. One day, after noticing the state of the teeth of the guests at Gum for breakfast as Brady was serving, he had a conversation with Lilia Moore from Cone Hospital and Congregational Nursing Program. And out of that conversation, Dale Finn is here as well, came the Missions of Mercy Dental Clinic for the homeless, which began in 2011 and continued for several years, serving over 1,000 people who could not afford dental work at the time each year. And also at the Friday breakfast, Pastor Brady and Skip McMillan had their first conversation about what to do about homeless people during the day. And with Brady's encouragement and input, Skip and others took the reins and gave birth to the IRC, the Interactive Resource Center in Greensboro, the day shelter for homeless people who were getting their back on their feet, and that began in 2008. Thank you, Todd, for sharing those memories and those moments of conversation. Brady just had a knack for bringing the right people together and sending them on their way with God's blessing and strength. And I apologize, but I've got to share two quick stories myself. Two stories that affect me personally to this day and always will. And those are ones that encounters I have with Brady that I will strive to honor and always have striven to honor with my life and my calling. It was the junior year of my undergraduate work at UNCG. I had transferred all the way from Greensboro College to UNCG. I was in the Bryan School of Business, and I was getting my business major, and I had a job ready to go. When I graduated, I was going into hotel management and already had a job lined up at a company who was going to hire me. And I was excited about that, but I had this unfinished conversation with myself and with God. And it was Brady who taught a class on spirituality at Wesley Luther Campus Ministry my junior year, and I attended the class and fell in love with God all over again because of Brady's teaching. And as I did that, I began to stir in my own mind and heart that calling that had been there since I was 6 or 7 years old. And finally, Brady took me to lunch and said, "Have you ever thought about being a pastor?" And then the conversation unfolded. That which I had feared, that which I had stayed away from, that which I had avoided, and it changed my life forever because he was the one who said, have you ever thought about this? I see gifts in you. And I'm grateful forever. And as a result of that, later that same year, Cindy and I had been dating. I asked her if she wanted to go to church with me. She had grown up in a very different denominational experience, and I wanted her to at least be familiar with Lutheran worship before the possibility of us getting married and my going to seminary. We came to First Lutheran Church, and Pastor Brady was preaching. Now, I asked Cindy on the way home after worship that day, I said, well, what did you think? And of course, her first reaction after not growing up in a liturgical church was, boy, there's a lot of ups and downs, aren't there? You know, the standing, the sitting, the kneeling, etc. I've never done that before. Lutheran calisthenics, right? But then came the conversation where Brady was at the heart. How come the preacher didn't yell at me? What? What do you mean? And she explained a little bit more about her tradition and how every week was the sin of the week, and she heard how bad she was and how she better get right with God or else. And she said he just talked as if we were having a conversation, as if I was the only one there. And it was all about grace. It was all about love. A few years later, I was in seminary. I was doing my field work at Resurrection Lutheran Church in Columbia, South Carolina. And Cindy was in the new members class. They went around the room and asked the new Lutherans, why Lutheranism, why joining the church? Tell us a little bit about your journey. And Cindy talked about that first sermon she heard from Brady and the love that exuded from him, the grace that literally changed the course of her spiritual journey. She indicated that she pretty much knew that eventually the Lutheran Church would be her home when she came here and heard Brady preach during our junior year in college. I hope to honor Brady with those two gifts that he gave me and he gave us, and he gave so many of us. And I hope to honor that for the rest of my life. So let's give Brady the last words. One quote that Brady insisted we share, and one scripture reading that was close to, if not his very favorite, because he got so excited about it when he talked about it and read it. The first is a quote from Henry Nouwen, Traveling with the Eyes of God. Henry Nouwen writes, traveling to see new sights and meet new people is exciting and exhilarating. But if we have no home to return to where someone will ask, how was your trip? We might be less eager to go. Traveling is joyful when we travel with the eyes and ears of those who love us, those who want to see our pictures, those who want to hear our stories. And like everything, I've updated it, and like everything that we post from our trip on Facebook, right? Nouwen says, this is what life is all about. It is being sent on a trip by a loving God who is waiting at home for our return, eager to look at every picture we took and to hear every story we have to tell about the people we met and the friends we made. When we travel with the eyes and ears of God who sent us, we will see wonderful sights, we will hear beautiful sounds, and we will meet wonderful people, and we will be happy to return home. We're celebrating his homecoming, and both God and Brady are smiling. So let's listen in conclusion to one last of Brady's favorite descriptions of our itinerary while we're doing this traveling. Because he would say to each and every one of you, as everyone has mentioned, you're still traveling, so go about your work and continue to be the people of God and the body of Christ you are. It comes to us from God through the Apostle Paul and then paraphrased as only Eugene Peterson can in the Message. Brady wasn't thrilled about everything in the Message, but this two verses he said, I'm always amazed. I hear something new every time I read it, he said. And it's fitting as Brady sends us off to keep on traveling the journey of faith with the eyes and ears of God. Romans 12, 1 to 2. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for God. Don't become so well-adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what God wants from you and quickly respond. Don't be like the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity. Let God bring out the best in you, the well-formed maturity of Christ within you. He pulled that out of all of us. He could do it so well. May we continue to let that shine as we receive his legacy and do our best, strive our best to live, to honor his life and faith and the God whom he dearly loved. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand as we sing. We are God's people, united in the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, living together in trust and hope. We confess our faith. invite you to be seated for the prayers. Almighty God, source of life and peace, give courage and faith to all of us who are grieving, that we may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life. Grant to all of us who mourn a sure confidence in your loving presence, that casting all our sorrow on you, we may know the consolation of your love. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful God, we thank you. Bountifully thank you. For as we tell stories and share memories of Brady and his life, we realize how you have blessed us through him. We thank you, most generous God, for the wonderful gift of Brady and his life of faith. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to all of us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in the way of Jesus Christ, to be vessels of your forgiveness and grace each and every day. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant us grace, O God, to entrust Brady to your never-failing love, which sustained him in this life. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and remember him according to the favor you bear for all creation. God of mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the hope of heaven to all who believe. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands we commend ourselves, and the hands of love that hold us are holding Brady still. Thankful for those hands that have held us and reminded us of your love. And so with the church on earth and the church in heaven, we ascribe to you all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name, and we sing that praise and adoration now.
Thank you.
the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's life, death, and resurrection as the foundation of our lives. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please take your cup and your wafer. Start with the wafer on the small side and receive the bread, the host, receive the grape juice as fruit of the vine. And hear these words of blessing as you receive them. The body and blood of Christ given in love for you. Amen. Is your reign. into your hands our good and faithful shepherd. We commend your beloved Brady. He is a sheep of your fold, a lamb of your flock, both saint and sinner claimed forever by your eternal and faithful love. Receive him into the arms of your grace, into the promised rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of all the saints. Amen. We go forth in God's peace, trusting Christ's promises, empowered by the Spirit, to love and serve the world. Thanks be to God. Head on back to the fellowship hall. They'll be right with you, okay? Head on back to the fellowship hall, and they'll be right in, okay? Yeah. Thanks.
You're welcome.
You're welcome. Thanks. Hey, good to see you. How you doing? Good, thanks. Head on back to the... Lead them back to the fellowship hall, okay? Yeah. They follow you. They'll follow you. There you go. Yeah, there you go. Head on back to the fellowship hall. They'll be right with you. Head on back to fellowship hall, and they'll be right with you. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. You're welcome.
Thank you.
It's like, there's a lot.
You're still doing your